Unless I seem familiar. Could you bow your head and close your eyes? Father God, we love you, praise you, glorify you, and honor you right now. I thank you, God, that you are my Savior, you are our Savior. And while the world is struggling to find themselves, struggling to find the meaning, the purpose of life, you give us our daily bread every day. Each and every single morning, no matter how many times we mess up, your mercy is right there. Your mercy is our alarm clock. Your grace is our sunshine in the morning. As we are in your presence this evening, this night, I declare that your word will be spoken and your word will be received in Jesus' name. And I bind whatever distraction, whatever spirit of the enemy, whatever plans or attack the enemy may have for the service, I bind you up in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Satan, the Lord rebuke you. We believe that you will speak to us, and you have already made our hearts good ground to receive the word. In Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen. Grace and peace be unto you from God our Father, Lord Jesus Christ. I give all honor to God who's ahead of my life. Honor the pastor, the youth president, Brother Frank, my family, safe, everybody here. I honor you guys. So, we're speaking about, we're teaching about Leviticus, right? Leviticus is, let me see if I, Leviticus. Can you put the title up? What in the world is he talking about? He is not me, he is God. Now, I don't know about you, but there's sometimes I'm reading the Bible, or in the past I've read the Bible, and I literally had to think, what in the world is God talking about here? What in the world does he mean here? I'm not just talking about, you know, when you read the King James thing and kind of confusing the thou art, this thine, love it thine, neighbor do it thyself, all that stuff is confusing, but there are some things that I read in the Bible that even if I read it in a Message translation, I'm confused. And the book of Leviticus is one of the most controversial books in the Bible. One of the most misinterpreted books in the Bible. One of the most misunderstood things in the Bible. Even the controversial thing that's going on in the world, in the church also, such as tattoos, piercings, gay marriage. Everyone loves to go to Leviticus. They skip the love thy neighbor as you love thyself. They skip the forgive. They skip the give to the poor. They skip the gospel. They go straight to Leviticus because Leviticus is easy to misinterpret. Now, it may sound like I'm preaching, but I'm going to walk around and I'm going to pick some people to answer some questions. That's right. And this is not any, this is not seminary questions or anything like that. I see you, Frank. Don't pick Jessica. This is not, I'm not going to ask you seminary questions. I'm just going to ask you to give your opinion. But before I do that, one thing I want to tell you guys is, whenever you read the Bible, make sure you do so not to see if God is real or not, but do so with conviction that God is real. Because let me show you this. Hebrews 11 verse 6, and without trusting, it is impossible to be well-pleasing to God. Because whoever approaches him must trust that he does exist, and he becomes a rewarder to those who seek him out. If you're reading the Bible just to see if God is real, not, you're going to miss a lot of things, because the Bible is God-inspired. You can be reading, but he has to breathe the word into you. So, never read the Bible thinking, I'm looking for something to see if God is real or not, even though I encourage you to, if you are curious, to look into history, because one mistake that people make is when they try to convince others that the Bible is real, that God is real, they go straight to the Bible. They say, yeah, Numbers chapter or Genesis chapter or Revelation or Jesus said this. You can prove that God is real just by the history of this world. So that's not what I mean by don't go to the Bible for proof. I'm talking about if you're really going to study the Word, you have to first believe that God exists. He is who he says he is, and that's when he will reveal what he has to reveal to you. First scripture we're going to go to, Leviticus 21 verse 5. It says, priests must not shave their heads or shave off the edges of their beards or cut their bodies. Excuse me, I'm going to read that again. Priests must not shave their heads or shave off their off the edges of their beards or cut their bodies. Proof right here that God does not want you to get shape-ups. I just read it. I didn't make this up. I just read it. Priests must not shave their heads or shave off the edges of the beard. So everybody here with a shape-up, including myself, you guys are all sinning. I'm about to preach tonight. Is that what it means?
No.
Who wants to take a guess at what that means? Sarah? If you try to hide, I'm gonna see you. Come on. Take a guess. No lie, that's what I thought. When I read something, okay, back then God doesn't get a shape up, does he? He don't have a barber in heaven. God is all natural. Never gets a shape up. So naturally, of course, he would want his priest to be just like him. That's why priests cannot cut their heads, or cut their hair, or shave their beards, or cut themselves. Who wants to take a guess? Ralph, you want to take a guess? Who wants to take a guess? Just a random guess. Be honest. You want to take a guess? That's one of the reasons you're not supposed to harm yourselves, Charmaine. No, change your mind. I need some more. Who wants to take a guess? Shabby, take a guess. Go ahead.
Just image, you know. Don't alter your image.
Don't alter your image. Okay, that's fine. I need some more, Keisha. Your hair represents strength. That's a good one. I need one more. Deandra, you want to take a guess?
Sorry, did you repeat your question?
Okay, you see this, the Leviticus 21 verse 5, priests must not shave their heads or shave off the edges of their beards or cut their bodies. Yeah. You want to take a guess what that means?
What that means?
Why would God tell priests not to do that? Uphold a certain image.
I'm guessing not to be distracted.
Not to be distracted, that's a good one. You don't want to be too fresh, you know? Purity? That's a good one too. He's really close. One more. Eric? That's close too. That's pretty good too. So I'm gonna explain to you guys what this means. You know, but before I go there, you know how you ever been to a funeral and you ever been to a funeral? Let's say, you know, it's your mother's third cousin from Haiti that you never met, never heard a day in your life. So you go to the funeral and not to be messed up, you know, you're not particularly sad because you don't know the person. But then you see somebody over there acting crazy. That person doesn't know that person either, but they're crying now, "Woo! I'm gonna get them for that! Oh boy!" They're rolling all over the floor, doing all this kind of craziness. And at first you're like, man, life is tough, you know, they lost this person. But then, right after the funeral, you see they're all like, "Oh yeah, I'll talk to you later, girl, yeah, we still hanging out, right?" Like, they're all chill and everything. There are certain cultures who have people who, I forgot the exact name they call them, but professional mourners. They literally go to cemeteries and they make the same, some people in the United States do that too, they make the same just to liven up the funeral. What they used to do back then is part of their scene was they would shave their heads. They would cut their bodies. They would shave, cut different areas of their hair, cut their body to show, during the funeral, to show that this is how sad I am. Now, God told the priest specifically not to do that because as a priest, you know the truth, that this death is not the final destination. So as a man who represents hope, who knows hope, don't you dare partake in these things. Make sense?
Yes.
Next scripture, Leviticus 21 verse 10. And another thing I want you guys to always remember, simple thing, the Old Testament is Christ concealed and the New Testament is Christ revealed. The Old Testament is Christ revealed, he's hidden. You have to look for him sometimes. Things like this doesn't make sense. But who would have ever thought Leviticus 21 verse 5 was talking about Christ? Who would have ever thought that? Christ is concealed in an Old Testament, and he's revealed in a New Testament. Another scripture, Leviticus 21 verse 10, the high priest who has been ordained to wear the priestly garments must not tear his clothes. Who wants to take a shot at that? You can't tear your clothes, you can't rip your clothes up, and just so you guys don't think I'm trying to trick you, this has nothing to do with funerals. Well, it has something to do, but it's not the only thing to do with funerals, okay? You should be in one. That means anybody with ripped jeans in the house of God?
No, talk about it.
Talking about it. Who wants to take a guess? So we got the sexy priest in the church, you know? With the six pack and the pecs. Don't you dare rip your clothes and start seducing the women.
Okay, what I was thinking was, it's kind of like, you know how you're in a group, in a fraternity, and you can't drop the fraternity because you're forever in it. So I think that's what it is. You can't take off
your clothes. You can't drop your flags, right? You can't drop your flags, or the other priest is going to jump you, right?
I think it has to do with the covenant between God and the priest, because the priest, I know their garments, every single piece needs something. So if you rip it, it's like you're breaking the, you just destroy all of
them. That's true, that's close to. Anyone want to take one more guess? Want to take this? So he was right on. When Jesus was standing before the high priest, and I believe the high priest's name was Caiaphas, and Jesus declared who he was in front of the high priest. Now, they all heard him preaching, so they wanted him to come to court and make it official. Tell us who you say you are if you really think you are the Son of God. So Jesus stood before the priest and he said that he is the Son of God, and you'll see the Son of God, meaning you'll see him seated at the right hand of the Father. Now, that was the ultimate disrespect. Now, I could imagine, they probably imagined, thought that, okay, just come here and say, I'm kind of the Son of God, you know, not boast about it. Not only did he say he was the Son of God, he said that I'll be seated at the right hand, which made, because let's say there's a king and then there's a prince. The prince himself is highly esteemed, the prince himself is highly ranked, but he is not the king. For Jesus to say that he's going to be seated at the right hand of the Father, he was saying that he was king, equal with God. So Caiaphas was so upset that he ripped his clothes, forgetting that when a priest ripped his clothes or ripped his garment, he is saying, I am no longer at this seat, I am no longer in charge, I'm making way for the next priest. So when he was standing in front of Jesus and he ripped his clothes, not knowingly, he said, Jesus, take your seat. Who would have thought Leviticus 21:10 was speaking about Christ? And this is kind of a long one. Kind of a long one, Leviticus 21 again. Listen up. The Lord said to Moses, say to Aaron, for the generations to come, none of your descendants who has a defect may come near to offer the food of his God. It's kind of messed up, right? No man who has any defect may come near. No man who is blind or lame, disfigured or disformed. No man with a crippled foot or hand, or who has a hunchback or dwarf, who has any eye defect, or who has festering or running sores or damaged testicles. No descendant. I don't know what you mean behind that one. No descendant of Aaron, the priest who has any defect, is to come near to present the offerings made to the Lord by fire. He has a defect. He must not come near to offer the food of his God. He may not eat the most holy food of his God as well. He may eat the most holy food of his God as well as the holy food. Yet because of his defect, he must not go near the curtain or approach the altar and so desecrate my sanctuary. I am the Lord who makes them holy. That's messed up. So these people, it's not like they broke their own leg on purpose. Some of them were born crippled. Some of them were born blind, born deformed, hunchback, dwarf, all that stuff. One testicle, one nut, whatever the case may be. And God is literally telling them, don't you dare come here. Want to take a shot, Keisha? That's a good point, but that's not exactly it. You see? You're in the area, you're on the Ave, you folks. You want to take a shot?
I guess it makes me think of like the sacrifices had to be perfect as well. So I guess you can't have someone who is effective in that position because it just makes it.
You're really, because I'm actually going to get to that point exactly.
What did you say?
The sacrifices must be perfect. But the reason why God told these people not to come in, if you listen carefully or read carefully, he said that even if they can't offer sacrifices, they can eat the food. It's because God did not want any distractions in the sanctuary. And these people, it's not like, I mean, we over here in the United States of America, New York City, and we know when this sister cannot walk in heels and she's coming to church. We know when that brother wears the same suit every Sunday. We are so easily distracted. And God was saying here that he wants all the attention on him, so he does not want anyone that's deformed to come into the sanctuary, even though they may eat the food. Another one. Chapter 22, verse 6. The one who touches any such thing will be unclean till evening. He must not eat any of the sacred offerings unless he has bathed himself with water. So if you're unclean, meaning if you touch, and based on what you did to become unclean, there was a certain time period that you would remain unclean, even though washing yourself would not clean you. Why do you think that is?
It's spiritual and it's not a physical thing.
It's spiritual, not physical, that's close. Maybe some of you guys are confused. If someone touched a dead animal, been around a dead person, a priest been around a dead person, or someone who has been around a dead person will be considered unclean, they would say you have to stay a certain period of time labeled as unclean, and then you would have to go into the water and bathe yourself. Maybe God, some people been around some stinky stuff, you need to take a shower, put some deodorant maybe? Maybe? Anybody want to take a guess? Joker? Take some time to be cleanse spiritually, just like Nate said. Anyone else want to take a guess? So again, the washing of water did not clean them literally. But what it was a public statement that you are being cleansed. What is baptism? And I want to take the point to say, because a lot of people are confused sometimes saying, some people believe that if you're not baptized, you won't make it to heaven, or if a person is a born-again Christian and say, I'm born-again Christian already, I don't need to be baptized, I don't want to be baptized. Baptism is the appearance or the public statement that you are a new creation in Christ. Christ has healed you, you are no longer unclean. You're literally telling the public. It's like when someone gets married, they go to City Hall, they go to the court, they get the certificate, they are legally married. But then they have the public ceremony to let everyone know, I am married. Verse 19, you must present a male without defect from the cattle, sheep, or goats in order that it may be accepted on your behalf. Do not bring anything with a defect because it will not be accepted on your behalf. Anyone want to take a shot at that? You want to take a guess? Why would God tell you or tell the Israelites not to bring a sacrifice that had a defect? That means, I don't know if you guys are familiar with kosher food. If you go to the market, you know it's like 10 times more expensive than any other kind of meat or whatever they sell them. They literally have to investigate the animal. Like, make sure the animal doesn't have cancer, make sure the animal doesn't have anything dead inside of it. So many things, but they wanted the animal to be perfect. You want to take a shot? Yeah, why did it have to be perfect? She said it, and Rachel kind of said it too. Rachel exactly said, I mean, when you brought a sacrifice to God, God wanted it to be a representation of Him. You have to bring that perfect sacrifice to Him, without spot, without blemish, without wrinkle, or else He will reject it. Now, this may sound a little stupid, but the worst Christmas gift, I remember when I was in third grade. Ain't how Christmas means a lot to little kids, right? So we had Secret Santa, and I remember the person that I got to give a gift to, I'll never forget, I bought him this huge Undertaker action figure. Oh man, I wanted to keep that joke for myself. So I'm thinking to myself, if I'm giving somebody this Undertaker action figure, imagine what I'm going to get. So, you know, we get to class, and I'm literally, you know, when you get somebody a good gift, you want to be all up in their face, like, open it, go ahead, open it, see what I got you, see what I got you. So, the kid opened the Undertaker present, he was so happy, excited, not only was it an action figure, but what you could do was you put water in it, or you put whatever you want in it, and you press a button, and it's like you're sweating or bleeding, you know, so cool. So, I'm thinking to myself, if I gave him that, just imagine what I'm going to get. So, finally, I'm about to open my gift, and the kid that gives it to me say, hey, I didn't buy it for you, my mom did. Right there, I'm looking at him like, don't you dare. I opened it and I saw the 64 pack of crayons. I was so disappointed still to this day. I never forgot that. When you give somebody a gift, you want it to be a representation of you, you want it to be a representation, more importantly, you want it to be a representation of yourself. If you love somebody dearly, you never want to say, oh, here's some socks, you know, here, I saw you got some ripped stockings, every Sunday you got ripped stockings, here you go. Or here's a coupon to get a pedicure, I see you need a little work done. You want to make sure that what you give that person is to the best of your ability. That's exactly what God is saying here. Whatever you give Him has to be the best. The main thing that God wanted the priest to do is not to get contaminated. To stay away from contamination. Now, people at work make fun of me all the time. Some of you guys make fun of me all the time. Call me OCD and all that stuff. Because I carry hand sanitizer everywhere I go. Because I don't want to shake people's hands like that. But people at work, they get on my case even more. So, and on top of that, they're the opposite of germaphobe. Like, they're the people, I don't know about you guys, but at my job, everything is automatic except the bathroom doors. Everything. The sink automatic, trash automatic, but you have to touch the bathroom doors. And what makes it worse is, for some reason, they put the sink outside of the bathroom. So you know everybody that touched that handle had their hand on something else. So you can imagine, for someone like me, how that drives me crazy. So they always make fun of me. I'm telling them, like, your germs are everywhere. I don't want to get contaminated. When I get home, this is what I do. Somebody's home, I say hi to them. I take my phone. Lights on. Shh. Shh. And I walk away for 10 minutes. Come back, wipe it down. Then I feel comfortable. I'm to the point where if I don't wash my hands when I get home, I feel it. Like, I'm looking at my hands like, I don't want you. Like, you're not mine. You're dirty. And all that stuff. It goes, and that's looking at me like I'm crazy. But it goes that far. I don't want to be contaminated. I don't want to catch a flu. I don't want to get sick. And most importantly, I know I've seen people do nasty things. I've seen people dig up their nose and then shake a person's hand that they didn't even ask. I've seen people scratch the south of the border. You know what I mean. South of the border, they done scratching. I mean, they're clawing down there. And then they want to serve you for two people, two guys at my cafe. I mean, I keep records. Two guys at my cafe, I monitor. But when I see someone around food, I make sure, trust me, if you're around food, I'm watching. I'm watching. So these two guys at the cafe, not to sound too disturbing or anything, I'm in the back right now, and some nasty things falling. And this dude. And this dude, mind you, like, I don't want to sound too nasty, but I'm just sitting there doing number one, and he's there doing whatever comes after number one. And I don't know if he's like, what was wrong with him, but it just fell, flush, got up. Like, no, it don't happen that fast. It can't be. So me, I'm like, no, I have to see who that person is. So I rush out the bathroom, I saw this guy, and I'm expecting, though, when I rush out the bathroom, I'm expecting this guy, to use the soap and everything. There's a safety literally does this. And he works at the cafe, serving people sandwiches. So I'm thinking to myself, I'm never ordering different from there again. But then there's another guy who works, two people work there, did the same exact thing. So because of what they did, I already know, I don't want to be contaminated, so I'm not going to touch, I'm not going to be around them or anything like that. It takes 1 to 4 days to get infected with the flu virus, or for a flu virus to start manifesting. Meaning, if I have the flu, I can shake Angela's hand today, and 4 days later, it may show up. And she may be thinking to herself, I stayed home the past 2 days, how could I get the flu? She's been contaminated and she don't even know it. There's a story about, a true story about a man who was in a cult, and one of his assignments, and before I say this, have you ever passed by a homeless person and they're asking for money, but you feel pulled not to give it to them? And maybe you think to yourself, they're going to use it for alcohol, drugs, or whatever the case is. But there's a bigger reason why God may be holding you back. So this man was in a cult. His job was to go out, pretend to be a, one of his jobs was to go out and pretend to be a homeless man. And when he's a follower of Christ, now he's a believer, and he's given his testimony. And one of the things he said was, while he's there begging, he knows who's a Christian and who's not a Christian. He knows who's a Christian because they would have a fire around them. And whenever he would beg for money to those people with the fire around them, they would not have compassion for him. But those who do not have the fire, they would have compassion and give him some money, and that's how he gains influence over some people. But he said, sometimes God is speaking to Christians and he's telling them, get out of this area. Move away. But the Christians, lingering a little bit, I'm swaying a little bit, in 5 minutes, in 10 minutes, or whatever the case may be. He says the longer the Christian waits, the more the fire decreases on them. And if they stay too long, that fire completely eradicates, and that's how he has influence over them. The reason I'm telling you this is, contamination happens when you don't see it. You may think to yourself, I'm just smoking a little weed. Nobody knows. My best friend doesn't know. My girlfriend, my boyfriend, my wife, my husband don't know. It's going to catch up to you. You may be thinking to yourself, I'm in my room at night in the dark watching pornography. Nobody knows. Nobody knows it's a struggle. It's not hurting me. I mean, it's not hurting me. It's not hurting anybody else. Nobody knows about it. It's going to catch up to you. You may be thinking to yourself, I have unforgiveness in my heart. I can pretend to be friendly. I know how to smile. I know how to fake it. But that's going to eventually catch up to you. God gave the priest so many rules. And sometimes he gives us so many rules. Don't watch horror movies. That's something that I'm personally big on. Now, you may be a fan of horror movies, but horror movies are going to catch up to you. I don't know if you guys have ever been to a deliverance service where things got crazy, but it's literally an exact replica of what they're showing in the horror movies. Worse sometimes. these things will catch up to you. If you feel God knocking on the door to your heart, you have to obey it. I remember when a few years ago, I was doing exactly what I'm telling you not to do, and God had to give me a wake-up call. I had a dream where I saw someone on the billboard, and that person said, on the billboard it says, "Warning, you are not too high to fall." And this is me doing ministry, thinking nobody knows what I'm doing, this is just my getaway, I'm not hurting anybody, I'm not hurting myself, this is just how I deal with things. And that warning came to me, "You are not too high to fall." And by the grace of God, I heeded that warning. But we all here have to be diligent and listen to the warning that God put in our heart. It's not worth it. That boy, that girl is not worth it. That joint is not worth it. That bottle is not worth it. The club, the party life, those friends, they're not worth it. The what you're watching on TV, on the internet, it's not worth it because you're getting contaminated. And before you know it, it may be too late. Stay away from contamination. The Passover. Verse 21, it says, "If you present a peace offering to the Lord from the herd or the flock, whether it is to fulfill a vow or it is a voluntary offering, you must offer a perfect animal. It may have no defect." I went over that already. But what I want to highlight here is, in different translations, it highlights how the animal that you have to give for sacrifice, it cannot have any broken bones. Anyone want to take a guess why? Why did it highlight that? Not exactly. Well, it could have many means, but that's not the point I was trying to make. That's exactly what it was. Psalms 34 verse 20 prophesies, "He protects," we're talking about Jesus here, "He protects all his bones, not one of them will be broken." And what happened in John 19:36? "These things happen so that the scripture will be fulfilled, not one of his bones will be broken." Now maybe you think to yourself, because when I first read this, I thought to myself, wait a minute. They took some large nails and they pierced them right through God's hand. But what happened was the bones moved out the way. If you look at the hand bone, it's not all intact. So when the nails went through, it literally moved out the way. Not one of God's bones was broken. You see how everything in the Bible reflects Christ? Christ is concealed in every little bit of detail in the Bible. From Genesis to Exodus to Leviticus and so on, God is revealed, has revealed himself. Now, when the Psalms speak about searching for God, it doesn't mean look under the tables, of course, look under your bed, look in the closet. It means this. It means go into the Word and dig for Him. Look for Him. Because as you're looking for Him, He's revealing Himself more to you. And the more He reveals Himself to you, the more obedience you'll be able to give Him, the more discernment you'll be able to give. The feasts were to announce, Leviticus 23 speaks about a lot of feasts, and I know feasts and offerings, and I know Jamie covered that. But the feasts were to announce a specific time period of natural season and a sacrificial reminder, but they also made a reference to Christ. Example, the Feast of Booths. Now, the Feast of Booths were something that took place, and for 7 days, people had to live in booths. They literally had to live in booths. Now, this one, I'm not gonna lie, I had to do a little more research. It just doesn't make sense. Why would God tell you to leave your home to live in a booth? Anybody want to take a guess? Maybe, you know, God was looking further into time. He knew that phone booths would be something. So he had people in booths to call on his name. Oh. Anybody want to take a guess? Keisha? Say it again. That's part of the answer. To humble yourself. Get away from distraction. That's a good one, but that's not exactly it. Anybody else? Jonathan, you want to take a...
Actually,
You don't know? Anybody want to take a guess? There might be some more guests. MC in the back.
What? take you away from what you think is most important, like the house, your security, kind of.
That's good, but that's not exactly it. I didn't forget about your friend, Jessica. You want to take a guess? You want to take a guess? No, just say it. Whatever you think it is. Can't put it together.
Is it some kind of like
prayer
closet?
Prayer closet? Maybe if you bend it, you know, you'll push it, push that in as the answer.
Does it have to do with anything when Jesus was on
the mountain praying? No, it has nothing to do with that. Think about it. I need some more opinions first. Think about it. God told all these people to build a booth, use strong branches to build a booth and stay in there, or go in there for 7 days. Do this for 7 days. Noah built the ark? No, it's not exactly. Keisha? No, not really.
Is it supposed to signify when Jesus has to fast for in the wilderness?
Nope. 7 years. I'm gonna give you guys a hint that my answer doesn't include anything with the numbers. I'm just telling you how long they had to stay in there. What? One more guess. Jolene. To get you out of your comfort zone? Not really. This is multiple verses that speaks about it. But you would have to do like further research. Because the Bible doesn't tell us say exactly why. A lot of these answers, you have to do historic research. Know that why the Jews did this, why the Israelites did this, why did they go to this location. Don't expect the Bible to just say, God said this and this is why, this is where you can find it. You have to do your research. Because a lot, same thing, this is a popular example when Haitian says "stop by say my bullet," if you translate that in English, "what's up, I'm burning." That makes sense. You ever heard of, like, all these Haitian proverbs? Like, one thing my father loves to say is, when he gives my brother, sister, or I something to work, like something to do that they should have done, my parents should have done, then he says, "to stop and weep, fait pitié." So you know, with the Lord. So if you say that in Spanish, you know, they're like, what are you talking about donkey for? You say that in English, it doesn't make sense, but you have to know the Haitian background to understand it. Same thing, when you're reading the word, try, especially in the Old Testament, even in the New Testament, try to go in and study some history to know exactly why it was done. But these men, some of them had to use strong branches to build a booth and stay in there, or go in there for 7 days, while other men carried smaller branches. And the reason why God told them to do that was to cause them to remember their slavery, their bondage in Egypt. And the men had to walk, literally, the men with the smallest waist had to walk crying out, "Hosanna," which means, "Save us, we're asking you to save us." So not only was it a reminder of where they were, but it was also a reminder that Christ would deliver them from the bondage of sin, from the slavery of sin. So God required them to stay in the booth to remind them again of where he took them from in Egypt. They were in physical bondage in Egypt, and God delivered them. Now they're in spiritual bondage by sin, and one day God will deliver them again. You see how that works? Last but not least, sacrifices were mandatory. They had to keep the sacrifices coming. They had to keep it coming. If you read Leviticus, and I hope you guys have been reading it throughout this month, but if you read Leviticus, God gave so much detail, this amount of ox, this amount of lamb, this amount of grain, and he wanted it to be continuous, because as long as the sacrifices were going, he was able to complete it. It allowed him to not look at them with contempt. But the moment the sacrifices stopped, God and Israel were enemies again. God and Israel were not on the same side. The moment the sacrifices stopped. One of the reasons why Jesus speaks in Isaiah spoke also about entering into God's rest. It's because before Christ, he had to do so much just so God can be pleased. for you from that very moment. Once you stopped, he wasn't pleased again. Once you stopped, he looked at you with contempt. Once you stopped, you were no longer his son, his daughter, his child. Once you stopped, he rejected you. But when Christ came down, he was that ultimate sacrifice. He was that sacrifice so that no matter what happens, God's able to look at you and say, I'm pleased with you. You no longer have to offer up the sacrifices. You no longer have to offer up the grains. You no longer have to celebrate all these feasts. You no longer have to go and stay in these booths, because what Christ did for you on the cross is sufficient for all eternity. And I heard someone say, give this example before, when you commit first-degree murder, that's murder with intent, you get a life sentence, because a life is worth a life. Because Christ's life is worth eternity, we have forgiveness for eternity. Does that make sense to you? The Bible says that it was not possible for the blood of bulls and goats to cause God to forgive you for your sins, because it was only temporary. It's like, have you ever been to a restaurant and you ate so much that you can't stand the sight of food? But what happens in a few hours, you get hungry again. That's how God was, right? You offered him a sacrifice, he'll be satisfied for that moment, but in a few hours, a few days, months, years, whatever the case was, he will look at you and he will want more, more, more. And as human beings, we naturally got tired. But now what happened, because Christ was that ultimate sacrifice, whenever he wants more, he looks at Christ. Whenever he wants more, he looks at his right hand, at his right hand. Whenever he wants more from you, whenever he looks at you, he sees that ultimate sacrifice that was paid for you. The Old Testament is Christ concealed, and the New Testament is Christ revealed. Now, I hope you guys receive the word that God has for you. And most importantly, I hope that you always remember that Christ is in everything in the Old Testament. If I want you guys to take one thing, is that Christ is in the Old Testament, and begin to read it. Begin to ask God to reveal himself to you. Begin to ask God to show himself. Go ahead and read Genesis and just pick a verse. Choose a chapter and just dissect it. I guarantee you it will show you something about Christ. God bless you.